On the 23rd day of the month of September, in an early year of a decade, not too long before our own, the human race suddenly encountered the greatest show in its very existence. And this terrific show surfaced, as such masterpieces often do, in the seemingly most innocent and unlikely of places. Welcome to Film Prov, where everything is made up and my opinions don't matter. Little Shop of Horrors is without a doubt my favorite musical. It was the first show I ever did in high school, and actually it's what attracted me to joining theater in the first place. And it sparked a love of performing and entertaining that still persists in my life today, hence this YouTube channel. But with a dedicated passion for a piece of media comes the inevitable hot take. The Little Shop of Horrors film was completely justified in changing the ending of the musical, and I preferred the film's theatrical ending to the film's original one. So before you guys hop into the comments to tell me what an uncultured film bro I am, or before you normies and straights ask, what the hell is this guy talking about, let me give a little bit of backstory. In 1960, filmmaker Roger Corman realized that he would have a film set rented two more days than he needed for his film A Bucket of Blood. Not wanting to waste it at all, he decided to film an entire separate movie on this set in just 2 days. He ended up with a horror comedy called The Little Shop of Horrors, about a meek florist shop employee attaining fame and fortune by growing a massive unidentified plant named Audrey Jr., while secretly feeding it the bodies of people who die around him. Its remarkable production story aside, it is a quaint and charming little B-movie, and it eventually gained a subtle cult following across the 60s and 70s. Come the 80s, enter David Geffen and the genius pair of Howard Ashman and Alan Menken. Yes, that Ashman and Menken. And these Ashman and Menkens. They looked at this humble little B-movie and rightfully thought, hey, this would make a really fun musical. Thus, in 1982, the off-Broadway show Little Shop of Horrors was born. This show added a trio of Motown-style singers acting as a Greek chorus, thinned out some of the characters and altered the names of others, and made it so that our giant man-eating plant Audrey II could not only talk, but sing with a bassy, jazzy, beautiful voice. The musical tells the story of Seymour Krelborn and Audrey, who work for the overbearing Mr. Mushnick at Mushnick's run-down flower shop in New York's Skid Row. Seymour discovers and eventually grows the massive Audrey II, a strange and interesting plant.
I couldn't help noticing that strange and interesting plant.
Hey, I just said that. That attracts business and fame for the shop and for Seymour. But secretly, the plant talks to Seymour and demands he feed it human flesh. Meanwhile, Seymour crushes after Audrey, who's completely unaware and instead dates the sadistic and abusive dentist Orin Scrivello.
DDS.
The musical was a massive hit, and only 4 years later, it spawned a musical movie adaptation. Suck it, everyone else. 1986's Little Shop of Horrors, the movie, was directed by famed Miss Piggy Frank Oz, and while he was most known for puppeteering and voicing various Muppets and Yodas, he's actually a very talented director and was a natural fit. The film stars Spaceballs and Ghostbusters' very own Rick Moranis as Seymour, and Ellen Green as Audrey. Green actually originated the role of Audrey in the stage musical as well, and this is actually the first time a movie musical has brought back a stage actor to the role they originated. The film keeps the story and most of the dialogue of the musical very much the same, only cutting a few of the more trivial songs, dropping a subplot about Mushnick adopting Seymour to keep the plant in his possession, and adding the certified bop Mean Green Mother from Outer Space, so the film could technically qualify for a Best Original Song Oscar nom. However, depending on the version you watch, the film may or may not completely change the ending for the musical. In the movie, after Seymour decides he's had enough of being forced to commit horrific acts to appease the plant's bloodthirsty demands, Audrey II instead takes matters into its own hands and lures Audrey I into its clutches, succeeding in grabbing her inside its toothy jaws and almost eating her alive. Seymour arrives just in time and saves Audrey. Seymour and Audrey are then approached by a businessman wanting to sell little Audrey IIs across the country. Seymour realizes that this is the plant's endgame, that it wants to take over the world one household at a time, and he confronts Audrey II. The plant fights back, revealing that in actuality, it truly is a mean green mother from outer space, and I'm destroying the Little Shop of Horrors, and is ultimately destroyed when Seymour electrocutes it with an exposed power cable. Seymour and Audrey marry each other, move out of the city, and live happily ever after. Or, that's how it should have happened. So, the musical does not have a happy ending. When Audrey is chomped by the plant, Seymour pulls her out, but the damage is done and she dies from her injuries. In her final moments, she tearfully asks Seymour to feed her body to the plant once she passes, so that she can continue to nourish the plant and bring him the success and happiness that she wishes for him.
So in a way, we'll always be together.
He tearfully and regretfully obliges, and gives her to the plant after she fades. Soon after, while wallowing in his depression, he meets the businessman I mentioned earlier who wants to sell the plant. Again, he confronts the plant and tries to kill it with a gun and poison, but nothing works. Grabbing a machete, Seymour charges headfirst into the plant's maw, completing his character arc, atoning for his sins, and ensuring that either the plant will die, or he will. He dies, and Audrey 2 becomes a big hit, selling to houses across America and becoming bigger than Hula Hoops, soon enacting their plan to take over the world. You see, Frank Oz originally intended for this to be the ending of the film, same as it was in the musical. He filmed the entire ending, including an extended sequence for the final number depicting giant Audrey 2s rampaging throughout the city as they began their conquest of the Earth. However, not one, but two test screening audiences reacted very negatively to the movie. They seemed to love and enjoy it, laughing at all the jokes and applauding after each musical number, until the second Audrey died, at which point they fell silent. The studio needed at least a 55% would recommend rating to release the film. They only got 13. With the entire film at stake, Oz made the difficult decision to scrap the ending and reshoot it, ending instead on the happy note with Seymour and Audrey ending up together. He was upset about it, as both him and model supervisor Richard Conway had worked so hard crafting the rampage sequence and were very proud of it. But ultimately, the choice to change it ended up saving the film, although Oz was never fully satisfied. Cut 2013, when the Blu-ray Director's Cut is released, with both a theatrical ending as well as the restored original ending, enabling people to watch both in full remastered HD. Now, ever since the original ending was released, there's been some interesting discourse around the obscure but relatively strong Little Shop fanbase. The overwhelming consensus is that the original ending is far superior. The theatrical ending is too cheap and saccharine and cliched. And the narrative is that the general masses are dumb and just want their happy ending. This ending is true to the original musical, and is more narratively satisfying that Seymour ultimately pays for his sins instead of being let off scot-free, and that Frank Oz is right in preferring the original ending. Now, this is where my big brain contrarian opinion comes in. Because I do not think the original film ending is superior. In fact, I think it's the worst ending of any version of Little Shop. So first off, let me give my concessions and acknowledge the good things. I do appreciate that the original film ending is actually based on the musical ending, versus the theatrical ending, which is just made up and tacked on. I also very much appreciate all the care and love and work that went into that rampage scene. It paid off spectacularly. And this sequence is phenomenal to watch, especially with the banger of that finale song, Don't Feed the Plants, which sadly is not in the theatrical ending. I particularly like the last part, where the army comes in and fires the plants as they climb the Statue of Liberty, giving us that classic B-movie ending card, followed by the plants ripping through the film itself. Now with that being said, the sequence is way too long. The theatrical rendition of Don't Feed the Plants from the original stage musical is around 2.5 minutes. Of course, there's nothing wrong with lengthening it a little bit to show off the spectacular sequence and the models and the special effects they were so proud of, but come on, this sequence in the film is over 6 minutes long. Trim it down for the love of God! The movie otherwise has great pacing until this moment. But now it just drags on so long, and by the end of it, you're just looking at the clock or checking your phone and just wondering how long it's going to go as this all becomes just noise. All the scenes and sequences are phenomenal to look at on their own in a vacuum, but there's quite a few that could be trimmed down for time or just cut entirely. Considering the fact that this entire sequence is spectacular to look at, there would definitely be enough meat left over after trimming down a minute or two that you're not really sacrificing the impact of the scene. However, I maintain that this ending is the worst ending of any version of Little Shop for more reasons than just that. First off, I completely understand why film audiences were put off by it. Frank Oz himself rationalized in an interview later that the grim ending works on stage because there is that inherent unrealisticness that comes with the stage performance. The audience knows they're looking at a stage with puppets and actors. They know that there's only three walls on that set, and that those actors are just people in the room just like them, walking around with microphones and costumes reciting lines. Even when the characters die, they're still gonna come back at the end to take a bow. Film, however, is far more immersive than that. Even with something as campy as Little Shop, the world feels real. The characters feel real, and we get to spend time with them as real people. When one of them dies, they don't come back for a bow. They're really dead. The final moments we see of them are filled with pain and sadness, instead of a standing ovation and a triumphant bow. That gives the deaths a lot more intrinsic weight to the audience. Not to say that a character's death in a play or a musical can have its weight, it just is usually more intentional on the part of the artists themselves. If you ask me, and no disrespect at all to Frank Oz, it's a lot more than just that though. Another difference between film and theater is that film is inherently a lot more intimate, simply because you are watching from a lot closer. In a play or stage musical, the audience watches from far away. Even a front row seat can be around 10 yards from the actors on stage. Compare that to film, in which the camera can get right up close to the performers, sometimes too close. We can see their faces so much more clearly, and it's a lot easier to empathize with them. We see each little micro expression, and instead of watching from the outside, we feel like we're a part of the scene ourselves. Therefore, the audience is legitimately upset when they see these up-close shots of Seymour, when he sees the love of his life die, or when he himself is facing an immediate gruesome death. This triggers our empathy a lot more than your average stage performance, and as a result, it can be a real bummer to end on. We spend the entire movie with these characters, grow to love them, want to see them succeed, only to see them lose and lose so miserably at the very end. However, I have yet another reason for thinking this ending isn't that good. And this is an opinion I've never heard anyone else have, or at least no one else with a platform that's reached me. So maybe I'm full of shit, who knows. But when I say that the original film ending is the worst of any version of Little Shop, what I mean is that there's more than just two versions. That's right, a lot of people automatically lump the original stage ending and the original film ending together, because they're the same thing, right? Audrey and Seymour die, Audrey 2 takes over the world, don't feed the plants. Same ending, right? Well, that's where you are wrong, my friend. I make a distinct and key difference between the original film ending and the stage ending. First off, yeah, Mean Green Mother is not in the stage version. I like the song, but it's beside the point. The main difference that I'm talking about is all about the way in which Seymour dies, and the agency he does or does not possess. He dies and is eaten by the plant in both versions, but in the original version from the musical, he dies fighting the plant. He chooses to charge headfirst into the plant's jaws, knowing full well that his chance of survival is almost nothing, and he is okay with that. He finally faces his demons, owns up to his horrific choices that have resulted in the deaths of three people, and leaps in, determined to either kill the plant or die trying. Either way, redeeming himself, and either way, he's okay with that. His death is ultimately his own choice and based on his own agency as a character. This completes his character arc in a satisfying way, even though it's sad, because he not only loses his meekness and stands up for himself and for what's right, but he also repents and pays for his sins that we've seen throughout the show. His death is ultimately his own choice and comes from his own agency as a character. Now contrast that with the original film ending, in which he stands up to the plant, but then the plant spends an over 4 minute long song essentially beating the shit out of Seymour, during which Seymour just scrambles around helpless and scared like a feeble little gerbil. His agency is taken away the second the plant starts singing, and he never regains it. When Seymour does get eaten, it's after the plant has successfully beaten the crap out of him and brought the entire ceiling down on top of him. He doesn't choose to go, he doesn't charge in, he doesn't have a weapon, he isn't even trying to fight. He's just plucked out of the rubble by the plant and eaten, sniveling and crying, in an oddly long and gratuitous shot. That is why I have a problem with this ending. Seymour's entire arc is not just about him slowly losing his soul to the evils of greed, it's about him slowly learning to stand his ground and stand up for himself. That is what is exemplified by him sacrificing himself to try and stop the plant, and that is what is robbed by the original film ending. That is why I believe it is so unsatisfying, to me at least. So where does that leave us? Personally, despite not being a huge fan of the original film ending, I am so glad that it is restored and available on the Blu-ray. That way anyone who wants to watch it can watch both versions and enjoy Frank Oz's original vision and honor the brilliant and difficult work that was put into the ending by Oz, Conway, and all the other artists and craftsmen who contributed to this. It's clear that this was something everyone was proud of, and it very easily could have become lost media, something which sadly happens way too much, even in today's digital age. Hell, they even have other cutscenes available online, such as the scrapped longer version of the musical number The Meek Shall Inherit. And at the end of the day, even the worst Little Shop ending is still Little Shop, so it's still a good time. Little Shop is a beloved cult classic, and I strongly recommend anyone check it out. Whether you're lucky enough to find a production of the stage show, or if you want to watch either version of the 1986 movie, or hell, even if you want to watch the original 1960 Roger Corman film. That one's free on YouTube, and is only an hour and 15 minutes long. Either way, please, enjoy the wonderful, campy joy that is Little Shop of Horrors, and of course...